judges or secular jurists, to be scholars around the secular Jewish law. But in this effect of life, that if you look at citations in the Supreme Court, for example, that you do need some educational, let's say, background. And what happened, that goes to the second question, what happened is that the first generation of Jewish law scholars was secular but had this educational background that was lost. This also is an answer to the second, to the question of what supposed we are interested in. This is a practical rather than a scholarly project. What is to be done? One thing one can do is insist on having, for example, required courses in Israeli universities where students are exposed to the complexity, richness, multi-level interest that one can have in this legal system. So there are debates whether this should be a basic course. In, for example, in my law school, there are some people who want to abolish the requirement of students to study Jewish law. I think it would be very bad because this, even if you don't think this legal system should be revived as a kind of background basis to the Israeli system, it's wonderful, a wonderful system to study from a comparative law angle, and for Israelis, especially the ability to read sources that are thousands of years old and to think about it comparatively is amazing. So it's a question of education. But it's also, the paper was normative, it's a descriptive paper. I'm not saying whether it's good or bad, I'm describing the process. As a descriptive paper, and as a historian, I think one thing that you can learn from the story of the 100-year history of Jewish law is that history is not linear. There's no rise or decline, it's a cyclical process. And just as if you think about religion generally, you know, if people would, somebody would ask people, including in here, in the former Soviet Union in the 1950s, or in Israel in the 1950s, where is religion? And then, well, what would be the future of religion? People would say it's obviously disappearing, it's a relic of the past. You see that in all the world, including here, including in Israel, including in the West, certainly in the third world, religion has not disappeared. So what you see, if you look at the process as a historian, that there's no one end, there's no evolutionary linear process. So, you know, if one would ask me normatively whether I'm concerned or not about faith, Jewish law and Jewish identity, I would say, I don't know. I would say that in the last 10 or 20 years, one of the most amazing processes that happened in Israeli society, but also happening in other religions, is that people who were formerly secular suddenly became interested in religion as a source of identity. Okay, not necessarily law. But what you see in Israel is an amazing flowering of interest in the religious sources. There's a secular yeshiva, there are, you know, reform, and the conservative Jews or movements were kind of exponentially growing. So I'm a historian, I'm not interested in normative aspect, I'm not saying where the process should go to, and whether identity can be, you know, law is important for identity or not. I'm just saying that I'm modest enough as a historian to know that there's no one end. And it's not linear, it's like, cannot prophesy what happened to identity and also to religious identity in 20 years from now. And the story is actually that secularism is cut in all the world.